In our study of the life divine, we are at this point of Sri Aurobindo's description where the evolutionary transition is being described based on past evolutionary stages. So Sri Aurobindo is following a logical pattern, looking at what was done by nature in the past, what are the methods she has followed, what are the hidden powers which are activated each time there is a step in evolution, and how this relates to the present transition from the human to the divine. In this, it was very clear that a new type will not involve the whole of humanity suddenly making a transition. It will be a few. He even uses the word a few especially evolved human beings. And once that transition is made by a few, the mass of humanity which is currently being pushed up will lapse back to something which is much more normal human mental status. And the important idea here is nature's push can align with the human aspiration to make that radical change. Once nature's push withdraws, the human aspiration on its own is not enough to make the biological change. It can still grow in consciousness, it can still continue to open to higher states, but the transition into a new species as a direct physical or semi-physical process would have been made, and after that the human species would remain as a rung, as a level through which a step can be taken to the next status, the new species. For the human being, the transmutation of consciousness, he says, will always remain possible when the flame of the soul, the psychic kindling, becomes potent in heart and mind, and the nature is ready. These are the two conditions which are necessary even now, and that will be there even later. Now, these two conditions are important because we see in a large part of humanity this restlessness to reach out to something higher. But what kind of impulse is it? Is it merely a reflection of nature pushing you, and so you feel restless and you like to talk about spirituality or read a little bit and feel good? Unless there is the soul becoming powerful in heart and mind, you cannot have this radical change. And second, unless your nature is sufficiently ready, you cannot have it. So these are two conditions which apply even now and would continue to apply even later. He's made a brief comparison that the spiritual aspiration is innate in man, and unlike the animal, the human being is aware of imperfection and limitation and the need for something more. And so from this we move to the next paragraph where he has set this comparison as a step to describing more deeply what distinguishes the two in evolutionary push. It must be observed that the appearance of human mind and body on the earth marks a crucial step, a decisive change in the course and process of the evolution. So in the course of evolution, meaning the direction evolution was going, there is a change. And in the process, the methods used by evolution also, there is a change. And this change he's now going to elaborate upon, because this changed course and process is our starting point for the spiritual transformation. It is not merely a continuation of the old lines. Up until this advent of a developed thinking mind in matter, evolution had been affected not by the self-aware aspiration, intention, will, or seeking of the living being, but subconsciously or subliminally by the automatic operation of nature. So initially, in the earlier stages, all up to the human appearance, there are two impulses, subconscious and subliminal. What's the difference? Subconscious is when a push comes, but you do not know why, you do not know what it is doing, you do not know where it is going. It is largely a part of the form of your machinery. For example, the mating instinct, hunger instinct, self-protection instinct. The moment there's a danger, the whole fear rushes in you, adrenaline release, instinctively you start moving, you cannot even think. These are impulses emerging from a subconscious push. Even if you go back to earlier stages, the animals are not even conscious of what emerges, because what emerges is itself remaining at a subconscious instinctive level. Even there is not enough mind to register that something is happening. It just does, almost like a machine. When a fly sits and your hand tries to swat it, the fly instantly moves as a reflex away. If the fly, you try to catch it anyway, it is so skillful it can escape. But if you look at the mechanism of that whole thing, at no point does it sense in awareness, danger is coming this way, I must run that, fly that way. It simply moves almost as a reflex. And therefore, you can easily trick the fly. If you really want to catch it, you do not catch from one direction, you catch from two opposite directions. And when you move like this, the internal instinctive mechanism is conflicted between escaping this way and the opposite way, and it gets stunned, it gets blocked, and you can catch. But once it comes to a sufficiently developed mental consciousness, although the impulse is there, you're aware that something is pushing you, you're aware that you're angry. But still, it is emerging from a subconscious. In the subliminal, there's a different category. There is behind an awareness of why this is there. You have something strange I feel, something is not okay with this. And then I start investigating. Something strange feeling is not coming from a subconscious, it's coming from a concealed knowledge which is subliminal, behind the limb, behind the borderline of our conscious range of awareness. I am not conscious of where it is coming from, but that thing is conscious of what the problem is. But because I cannot be aware of it, I only catch the impulse, something is not okay, and I start investigating with my mind. If that gap was not there, from within the knowledge would come out, yes, this is the problem here. And that does happen occasionally for us, but rare. So subliminal, Sri Aurobindo says, is not subconscious. In fact, a very large part of human behavior is the result of subliminal impulses. And it looks as if we are pushed to do, but they are not coming from a subconscious domain. In the Freudian psychology, there was an exaggerated base given to subconscious impulses. Later, there was a recognition of these subliminal pushes. But still, there is a great confusion in between what is subconscious and subliminal. Just because we are unaware of the source doesn't mean it is subconscious. So in the subliminal impulses, there are a lot of things which happen to us in our evolution, which we do not realize the source of. You have all heard some very unusual stories of how somebody, well, Amal Kiran here, opened a box in which he had purchased his shoes in Bombay, and the wrapping paper was a newspaper in which there was an article about Sri Aurobindo. He reads that and suddenly his whole being turns in that direction. Now, you cannot explain this from a subconscious or accidental event. Something internally recognized, brought the eyes sight to that point, and made aware that this is important to the surface parts. Panditji narrates how as a young boy, he goes into the library of his father, who has all these volumes of legal books, All India Reader, entire shelves full. They all look exactly the same. The only difference is on the spine there's a volume number. He goes into the library out of curiosity, pulls out a book, and it opens on the page of Alipur bomb case. His eyes fall on the name Aravinda Ghosh, and spontaneously the name begins to repeat within him. And he doesn't understand why. So he writes to Kapali Shastri, who happens to be in Pondicherry at the ashram, who writes back saying, one day you will understand the meaning of this. Now, how does a young boy go into this library, pull out a volume, open on the page, eyes fall on the word, and the inner being picks up? The only explanation is the inner being was already pushing forward towards this. And at the level of the inner being, the precise knowledge of how to get there is already present. And all that is needed is for the mind and body to not interfere, and it happens. But it's not subconscious. The thing behind knows exactly what it wants and catches it. So inevitably, in almost all of our lives, when we turned to the spirit, or when we had certain significant insights of this kind which appear accidentally, there was always a subliminal nudge, push, or even active guidance. And so the subliminal, in fact, plays a much bigger role in human life, especially when it concerns spirituality, than the subconscious. But well, going back in the earlier stages, these two were the only ways for the forward movement. And what has replaced later in our interest, he says, is self-aware aspiration, which can lead human evolution, intention, will, or seeking of the living being. Now, all of these are necessary in one form or other in the human life if you are to have any spiritual progress. But there are different kinds of things. So the fact that Sri Aurobindo bothers to mention these words, they are not meant to be similar meaning or one idea in which he just throws in several words. They are very distinct operations taking place. Self-aware aspiration. Within us, something awakes. It knows what it wants. I have an aspiration. I know this is what I want. And when something comes up in my life which conflicts with it, I can choose. The self-aware aspiration is already rare, and its source is already always from the psychic being. Less deep, more on the surface, is a self-aware intention. I have an intention to progress, and so that remains as an overall influence. And so every time I get a chance, this intention comes in. Its depth is less. The third layer is the will, which can also be self-aware. But the will is much more I am doing. When my will tires, I cannot. I am too tired. I am unable. But it's much more superficial. And then there is a seeking, which says, hey, I would like to follow that. This is interesting. This is curious. But there's no special push of the will. So you look at four layers, of which the most superficial is a kind of a seeking. Behind that, you take charge and you push. Your personal will is the drive. Behind that is a kind of an atmosphere of an intention which turns. And behind that is the aspiration which is coming from the psychic being within, but its first form in a reflection on the surface is, I am conscious of this aspiration which is within me. I don't know where it comes from, but it's very deep inside. And so I cannot go against it. I cannot cover it easily. So Sri Aurobindo has mapped out in a very simple sentence the difference between the animal and human phase. Four things here in the human phase. At the animal phase, you have only two things, subconscious or subliminal push. By the automatic operation of nature, and it happens automatically and therefore flawlessly, in most cases, perfect operation. So the animal knows to run away when there is an earthquake, flawlessly it knows which direction. In the human consciousness, we have a machinery which tells us, oh, there are rumblings inside the earth, there might be an earthquake. Which direction should we run? We don't know. We don't even know where the earthquake will actually take place. We just know there is something happening. In the surface part, largely you have ignorance, but conscious ignorance. In the animal range, there is the automatism of nature, which is unconscious, but it's perfect. So in a sense, you have gained consciousness, but lost the perfection of it. And the way is not to go back, but to go one step higher into the intuition, where again the direct action will come, but fully aware, with perfect, precise, flawless action. In between is the part of confusion, half light. So this automatic operation was so because. This was so because the evolution began from the inconscience, and the secret consciousness had not emerged sufficiently from it to operate through the self-aware participating individual will of its living creature. Now here again, very simple sentence, but the implications are very important when you explore. Recall, somewhere in the beginning of this chapter, Sri Aurobindo had described how in the push of evolution, there is the first darkness of ignorance and inconscience, and then the secret consciousness which is pushing through and is greatly struggling through and managing to push forward a few impulses. This was right at the beginning of the chapter. This, I'm reading from that portion in the beginning of the chapter. The obscure, mysterious creatrix ends indeed by delivering the secret consciousness out of its thick and tenebrous prison, but she delivers it slowly, little by little, in minute infinitesimal drops, in thin jets, in small vibrant concretizations of energy and substance, of mind, of life, etc. We had seen that. In that process, there were two things. There is this layer of inconscience, which is largely the matter. And there is behind secret, the secret consciousness struggling to emerge. And so when it first emerges, it is still wrapped very thickly in the inconscience, densely bound in the inconscience. When it eventually comes out sufficiently, there is a critical transition where this consciousness, having come out, is able to catch upon the will impulse. The animal has a will also, but the will impulse is largely automatic, semi-conscious or subconscious. So there's an urge, it bites. There's hunger, it eats. And this consciousness emerging catches the will and gives to it the direction that it wants. Very important description. This is what has to happen in us consciously. Now, we can say we are already conscious human beings, our will is already seized upon by the awakening consciousness. No, not fully. We're still largely operating in the animal phase, where there is an instinctive will and then there is a consciousness, and the two don't always align. This is famously stated as the spirit is willing but the flesh is weak. I think it's a biblical phrase. I want to do, I feel like doing, I have an aspiration to do, but I can't help it. My body is refusing. My body desires something different from what my mind wants. And the two are contradictory. Why? The will impulse is still largely rooted in the body instinct. The mind has awakened in consciousness, but the consciousness has not fully seized upon the will. When it is able to do this, whatever I choose to do, I can push and exercise the will from my consciousness. And although there is a lower will of that opposite impulse, I am able to literally force it out of that mold, of that track, and guide it to something else. So this is what has happened. The secret consciousness had not emerged sufficiently from the inconscience to operate through the self-aware, participating, individual will of its living creature. This power to be able to seize your own will and direct it from a knowledge, from a conscious awareness, is something which is not taught in our educational system. We are not made to do it normally. If at all it happens incidentally as a result of challenges we face. Or today I have to go for an exam, I don't want to go, I'm feeling tired. I have to run 100 meters where my body is sluggish, but the captain or teacher is pushing me hard. And so at that point, I push my will a little bit. In those few types of experience, we are actually learning to seize the will. You will find the same person who is now bored, suddenly he is offered some lollipop, some attraction, something which excites his passion. And the same fellow suddenly starts working hard and trying to do things which he never liked to do. Typically in teenage, when you see boys suddenly dressing up well and combing their hair, looking good, you know, okay, this guy is now attracted to some girl. But the impulse was really an instinctive impulse, a drive, a need to impress because of the attraction. It was not a conscious lifting of the will. If there was a conscious lifting of the will, you would be able to dress up nicely without needing any external cause. Look good, look clean, look fresh, look beautiful. Why? Because I choose to do it. And this was something Mother gave a lot of importance to. She would wear from what was available, beautiful clothes, use makeup, use lipstick. Sometimes she taught to some of the girls of the ashram. In the early years of the ashram where there was not enough money, she would stitch patches on her own sari, reuse, repair as long as it could. So it was not out of any particular need or attraction or compulsion that she did that. When she was asked, why do you dress in beautiful clothes? She said, well, do you want the divine to dress in ugly things? So the whole point for her was to manifest beauty in form. And the principle was very simple. In the domain of matter, where form is the first principle, beauty is to form what truth is to idea. You cannot accept an idea which is false, isn't it? It would be contradictory to the mind's aspiration. In the same way, in the physical plane, to accept ugliness is like accepting falsehood in the thought. And so you have to make beautiful in the same spirit in which your mind seeks to know what is true. Your body should be able to express through beauty. Now this requires already some effort to pull our willpower and align it or activate it from this higher idea, because this idea has no resonance in our instinct. At best, as the young boy who gets now wants to dress well to impress another, is just a form of the instinct. The moment he is impressed, he lapses back. There's a very interesting pattern you see when people get married. The man hopes that the woman will continue to be exactly as she is after marriage. The woman hopes after marriage she'll be able to change the man. In practice, once they get married and there is stability of relationship, the man goes back to being exactly what he wants, refusing to change, and the woman changes, no more looking after him the same way he expected. And this is a pattern we see everywhere in all relationships of couples. Because both behaviors modified under the pressure of an instinctive drive. Once the drive has no more a place, things lapse back. Or in time, generally in a few years, they lapse in any case. And what I'm trying to show you with these examples is, in a large part, our human nature is still not fully seized upon by this awakening consciousness. Or if it is seized, it is only a lower part of the awakened consciousness, not our higher spiritual aims. So the message from this description is the need for us to take from our highest poise of awareness, to turn to the rest of our nature and actually seize and lift all those impulses and processes into the higher light, including our personal will. And I recall there were a few such examples in the ashram who stand out extraordinarily. Even in the midst of the most extreme discomfort or distress, they never allowed that standard to drop back. One of them was mother's granddaughter, Purna Prema. She had in her last few years some severe form of cancer. And those who were observing her, even while she was in the hospital, she was unable to function in her environment. The things she did, every gesture, every movement was done with full awareness, with full intention, with an aesthetic form of beauty and movement. At some point she reached out to take a vessel to spit blood. The whole movement was done with such subtlety and beauty even, aesthetic, almost like a ballet dancer doing it, at a time when her body was racked in pain. That is an extraordinary achievement, and you do not see this normally unless a person has worked upon it all their life. And so these are things we should recognize, not say, oh yes, that belonged to the animal phase, it's over. It's not over, because we're still in a large part animal. And that's why this description is so important. Sri Aurobindo could have said, oh yes, that part is finished, now let's focus on what we have to do, but it's not really over. And in showing you the difference between the two phases, we understand what are the new tools with which those processes also can be made more effective. So, the consciousness had not emerged sufficiently earlier, and so it was dependent on the external machinery. But in man, the necessary change has been made. The being has become awake and aware of himself. There has been made manifest in mind its will to develop, to grow in knowledge, to deepen the inner and widen the outer existence, to increase the capacities of the nature. Now, in the part of us which has emerged out of the animal nature, these are the four forms in which this will has already been developed. But again, as we look at these four, keep in mind still the roots of the will are largely in the animal impulse, and we need to complete that process. There has been made manifest in mind. It is in the mental consciousness that the change takes place, not in the vital, not in the physical instincts. And so from the mind, you have to penetrate down into those two. The will to develop, at the very character of the mind, is to push things to improve them. This is not normal for the vital, it's not normal for the senses or the physical. And so mind has to impose this will. To grow in knowledge, again very specific to the mental consciousness. The vital is quite satisfied with what it has. The physical consciousness has a very different way of knowing. It also can grow in knowledge, but its way of knowledge is experiential. It is in states of consciousness. And that is not there as an instinct to want to grow. When it experiences something, it absorbs, but it doesn't push to reach out. To deepen the inner and widen the outer existence. So internally you're aware of things happening within you, but then the impulse is to try to know the root of it. Externally, you're trying to widen and make more broad and flexible. And the two are related. And finally, to increase the capacities of the nature. Everything we can do, we want to now push to be able to do a little more and a little farther. Man has seen that there can be a higher status of consciousness than his own. the evolutionary stress is there in his parts of mind and life. The aspiration to exceed himself is delivered and articulated within him. He has become conscious of a soul, discovered the self and spirit. So now these are broad layers in the evolutionary stages of the human consciousness. If we think of it deeply, you will find the human mass is not all there. The human mass itself is as if stratified into four layers. In the lowest layer, what he has described here in terms of knowledge, will to develop, grow in knowledge, deepen inner, broaden outer. That's developed in a large part of humanity. But in the second layer, there is something more. Man has seen there can be a higher status of consciousness than his own. And so at this point you see somebody else, oh, they are more conscious, they are more capable, they are more aware of their environment. I can also be like that. And that's more than what you are feeling within yourself. That's the second layer that looks outside, sees other states, or recognizes briefly, yesterday I had this extraordinary illumination, why can't I be in it all the time? The third layer is where the evolutionary push is there in his parts of mind and life, the aspiration to exceed himself. So the evolution now ceases. Now it's no more, do I see this? Are there examples which inspire me or somebody from whom I feel jealous? There's something more I know is possible. That ceases you. Estrus, the root. Again, the word actually is normally used to describe a frenzy, an instinctive frenzy. But Sri Aurobindo, remember, is a master of Greek and Latin. In the root, it goes to the sense of a gust of wind. Something as if comes and pushes you. And you feel this lift. The character of the gust of wind is it pushes you, if you're open to it, like a sail. But the wind always has a tendency to lift. It is not a narrow push. There is an upward sense suggested. And the aspiration to exceed himself is delivered and articulate within him. So you realize you can do so much, but can I go beyond what I can do? And this part is not just there formed, but it has the power to express itself, articulate. This is a very important suggestion, and it goes to the Vedic symbolism. There is an urge in you, but you don't know how to express it. When that urge has sufficiently come into its own, then now you can actually say what it is. And at that point, we can say the urge has been individualized, has been organized, or at least has a possibility to be organized in your surface person. And that's when we will say the God is born. Literally, the sense is something emerging from within, pushing forward. You feel the urge, the estrus, and then at some point it breaks out from behind the veil and takes a distinct form. And we will say there's the birth of the God within you. And this idea of, that's why he uses the word delivered and articulated. Now the God is born, and now it is speaking, it is acting by itself, it is operational with its own will. So it's not a poetic description, it's literally a description of an experiential change. Whenever you feel within you some deep aspiration nudging, you can of course say, all right, that is what it is. Or you can become very quiet and allow it to emerge, even assist it by as if opening the way, opening the passage, removing the things, the denser layers which prevent its emergence, and then bit by bit you will feel the thing comes forward. Often one has the experience of something within pressing to push out, but it's facing tension, it creates a pressure, it creates even sometimes a pain, and you don't know why. But if at that point, instead of struggling and becoming tense, you relax and allow its emergence, then you have this movement of the delivery, birth, and then later its power to express itself. And then the fourth layer, of humanity. He has become conscious of a soul, discovered the self and spirit. Now remember, it doesn't mean you have realized and attained. You become conscious that within you is this divine presence. You have discovered, that is, the covering has been removed of the self and the spirit. Only a few days ago, somebody shared a link of an interview with somebody in Europe who is a teacher. He was in the Buddhist tradition, in the Zen tradition, then in the Christian mystical tradition, and so on. And he says, he describes in the interview how 4 or 5 years ago he had a sudden awakening and became conscious of the presence of God. And it was there, and when it was there, he realized that it had always been there throughout his life. All the years that he was struggling to find it and experience it, there would be occasional bursts of experience which would be lost very quickly. And then one day suddenly it's as if the veil was lifted and he realized it's always there. But the interesting part was, in the realization was the recognition, it was always there, even when I couldn't feel it, because it was as if I was looking in the wrong direction. So the sense of discovery. But then, this is the sad part. After that, it lasted for a few months in intensity. The intensity wore off. Now he is busy trying to teach. But what can he teach? And he himself says, I cannot teach. What do you say? You keep talking about, well, it's like that. It will happen. When it happens, it will happen. That's all he can say. And he says, the only way you can teach it is to kind of, by a contagion, let it happen. Otherwise, there is no other way to tell somebody how to do it. All of that being said, when you find the man in his personal life, he has gone through all kinds of crazy ideas, going to all kinds of strange things which have nothing to do with the spiritual experience. But now, because he's a teacher, he has to justify it by giving to it a spiritual twist. So he suddenly decided to change his sex and become a woman and some strange things. And you wonder, where is all this coming from? The problem was, the consciousness awoke to the reality of a deeper self and its presence, and then said, this is it, now I have reached enlightenment. Because that was the idea he had got from the Zen tradition, that you suddenly flip and there you have the light, it's over, there's nothing more to be done. But nothing of his personal consciousness has changed. His mind is still the same thing that it was. At best, it has moments of reflected light in his heart or mind, whatever form it may take. But he stopped there. This is the point here. Discovery of the self or spirit. You have discovered and you recognize it's there. But after that begins the real journey. How do you now deepen that contact? How do you develop the relationship further? How do you extend it into the all the parts of your being, and so on? Many things will follow, until eventually your whole consciousness is not only suffused with it, but transformed by it. That whole process begins from this point of the discovery. But if you stop there, it's a pity. So here, when Sri Aurobindo says he has become conscious of a soul, discovered the self and spirit, in some sense, all of us who have stuck with a spiritual life long enough are able to do that, because somewhere along the way this has happened to us. You've become conscious that within you there is this divine presence, or you have discovered the sense of or the reality of the self or the spirit. And it can happen in many various degrees. If nothing else, in the mind, you're reading something or you're contemplating something, and suddenly there's a click and you say, ah yes, it's so obvious, this is always there, or this is true. And it's the mind's first glimpse. And again, you could stop there or allow it to deepen, let it invade you, let the mind become quiet, and even you'll find deeper layers behind or higher than the mind, which now begin to perceive, which then allow for a much deeper experience. But somewhere something has been touched. And that's when you have really the sustained pursuit of the spiritual life. So 4 gradations he describes, from pure attempt to grow in capacity and knowledge and so on, to awakening to the spirit and then the pursuit from there. In him then, the substitution of a conscious for a subconscious evolution has become conceivable and practicable. Only when you have reached such a degree that you can say, oh yes, now you can replace the subconscious evolution by a conscious evolution. Even that earlier phase where you have the push to improve yourself, if it has taken the form where you dedicate your life to self-improvement, it can easily take a deeper spiritual turn. You will remember Mother's observation, which I have mentioned before, when a group of Russian gymnasts came to the ashram in the 1950s, and they were of standard close to the Olympic standard, and after their performance, which was extraordinary, the mother observed, if they had just a little bit of the spirituality, they would have been like the gods. That kind of meticulous, directed, organized, willful dedication for developing your body, making it conscious, pushing it beyond the limits of your normal human evolution. If into that you had brought in the spiritual light, all the rest would have had extraordinary benefits and results, taking you way forward. So even if you do not see obviously the spiritual turn, if you take the first layer only and dedicate yourself to it, from there it only needs a little bit of the light for the spiritual breakthrough. But with that, the subconscious evolution can be replaced by conscious evolution. And it may well be concluded that the aspiration, the urge, the persistent endeavor in him is a sure sign of nature's will for a higher way to fulfillment, the emergence of a greater status. Three things he points to, which are sure sign. The aspiration, the urge, the persistent endeavor. Again, very different things. Aspiration from within, I want that. But it doesn't mean it has always taken a form of a strong urge. I have a strong urge, but it doesn't mean it has taken the form of a persistence. I have occasional lapses, I have frequent lapses, or my strong urge kicks up every morning for about 1 hour when I do my prayer or other asanas or exercises, then it fades away. So you have three layers of that emergence, and these three having come into humanity, and he's speaking very generally now, even in the highest parts of humanity, then that's nature's will. In the previous stages of the evolution, nature's first care and effort had to be directed towards a change in the physical organization, for only so could there be a change of consciousness. So that's the earlier phase, where consciousness was dependent on the biology. And so nature had to push to improve the biology, make the nervous system more complex, more subtle, more wide in its capacities. Push the complexity of the human neuronal connections and organize portions within the brain dedicated to specific faculties. If you do not have those dedicated portions in the brain, you cannot express that particular grade of consciousness in your normal working. So for example, in the frontal lobe of the brain is the part which relates to or which recognizes the distinction between good and bad, right and wrong, the sense of morality, ethics, all the things which belong to the mental idea of good and bad. They do not exist in the animal domain. And so this frontal lobe is very specific to the human brain. In the animal consciousness, it does what it needs to do. The tiger will eat the deer. That's it. It's not a question of good or bad. It does not torture the deer. It does not try to experiment with it in negative ways. But the human being not only has a free will for which there's a focal point in the brain, but it has this particular part which is developed If for some reason that part is damaged, you lose the ability to distinguish, interestingly. There's a fascinating example, medically documented, of a person now almost 150 years ago in, I think it was in the United States of America, he was pushing dynamite, a worker in a quarry, pushing dynamite into a hole with a stick, and he hit too hard and the dynamite exploded. And an iron bar with which he was pushing shot through his jaw, went right through the frontal part of his brain and shot out from the top of the head. Now you'd expect the person will die. He looks around, he staggers for a while, shakes his head and starts walking. And he lives for many years thereafter. Big hole at top, big hole below, all the wounds eventually heal, but the frontal lobe of the brain is actually shattered. The only problem he had was slight slurring of speech, but he could not distinguish between good and bad. Interesting. Now, if you think about what this means, our faculty of mind's judgment of right and wrong, good and bad, is so deeply imprinted in the brain that if you knocked out that part of the brain, you are unable to express. Doesn't mean you don't feel it. Somewhere inside, somewhere above, subliminally, superconsciously, there may be things. But they are unable to connect into the body. Now, remember, this was an ordinary case of a relatively ordinary man. If it had been somebody with a spiritual aspiration, and the effort in his consciousness to will that part of his awareness to express in his actions would have formed in the brain a new center in which the sense of good and bad would get organized. Now that would happen if the consciousness pushes upon the body to try to express. And the brain is plastic. This is a very important principle which is becoming more and more important in the public sphere and in the medical field. They call it neuronal plasticity, where the brain is able to adapt and reallocate functions to different parts. If one part is damaged, it is able to shift that functioning to another part. But think about it. If the function was the product of the brain, the damage to the brain would have damaged the function. And there's no way to retrieve it because the portion which creates the function is damaged. But the neuronal plasticity is possible because actually the function is independent of the brain. It's a function of consciousness. And when the brain is damaged, the consciousness pushes, organizes itself and re-engages with a different part of the brain from which now it acts. And that's what makes possible neuronal plasticity. Our brain is sophisticated enough, our consciousness sufficiently freed from the brain that it is able to impose and reorganize the brain working. Now this is to show you that in the earlier stage of human evolution also, until those centers were organized, it was not possible for the personality to express the sense of good and bad or right and wrong. And so there have been many such things which nature has had to build. The first care and effort had to be directed towards a change in the physical organization. For only so could there be a change of consciousness. And this is true all the way through animal to the human. This was a necessity imposed by the insufficiency of the force of consciousness already in formation to effect a change in the body. So earlier there was consciousness, it was working, biology also was working, but there was insufficiency of force of consciousness in formation to effect a change in the body. As the consciousness was evolving, it didn't have enough force of consciousness to impose on the body. Now this is a very important idea. It's not enough to be conscious. The consciousness must then push to shape body. Let's say somebody had some problem of the brain, they had a burst vessel, there was bleeding. As a result, the person has now lost speech, or some part of the body has become paralyzed, What happens next? If the person sits and waits in the bed and says it will happen when it happens, oh, doctor says I can never get back because the brain is damaged, well, nothing much is going to happen. But if the person starts pushing and trying and persistently, the very fact that you try, what's it doing? Your consciousness and will is pushing against the part which is not responsive in the brain. When it does not get that response, either it triggers new neuronal connections which heal, rebuild, or it shifts to a side part of the brain and connects there, and then from there begins to organize and build the motor capabilities. Very similar to the child learning to walk. But in the child, because there's no damage and the brain is much more plastic, this whole thing happens in 8 months, 1 year at most. Whereas the developed brain, which has less plasticity, it has become more rigid, is able to achieve the same thing maybe in 2 years or 3 years, but still it can do it. But it must be pushing. So this force of consciousness on the body is a very important part. Not only it can change the brain's neuronal working, it can even change cellular working. Now remember, I spoke about certain experiments which I recently saw, heard about and saw the results from in one of the most advanced research labs in India. And what they were showing was people putting a will and energy onto the cells could control functions of the cells very precisely. And I mentioned there, they could even trigger neuronal growth, and it took place within 2 or 3 minutes that the action started. Now, if somebody from outside can do that to cells in a petri dish, how much more effective is your consciousness, your will, your energy on your own brain cells? In the body, when the brain cells, or the cells taken in a petri dish now, when the cells had certain kinds of illnesses, certain functions were not operative, the energy put and the will put immediately increase the operation of those functions. Why can it not be possible in the cells of your own body? But now see the difference. How often do you stop, actually turn attention to a part of your body and put a will, put an intention into it to change its working? Rarely, never. Only when you have an injury. You've hurt the foot, there's pain, so you're limping. But how often do you pause to infuse in the part where it is paining the urge to heal or for the pain to change? And one of the interesting things which is shown through these experiments is that when somebody has pain, another person from outside putting that intention to remove the pain actually removes it. And it lasts for hours. And if somebody from outside can do, you too can do it. So, two things we take from this description. First, you should pause to put intention in your body. And it cannot be just a vague intention, oh, this should get better. You have to put a precise intention and a precise will, and in it, the force of consciousness on the body. This we are capable of as human beings, and therefore we have to apply it. And especially if our goal is to make the body more conscious, or even spiritualize the body or intuitivize the body, well, this has to be done by conscious effort to imprint. Force of consciousness is the key word here. And so in the early stage of evolution, the force of consciousness was insufficient to change body, and so you had to work to change body in order to have the consciousness grow. Now, but in man, a reversal is possible, indeed inevitable. For it is through his consciousness, through its transmutation, and no longer through a new bodily organism as a first instrumentation, that the evolution can and must be effected. Now, this point Sri Aurobindo makes, can and must, it is inevitable, that through his consciousness, through his, its transmutation, and no longer bodily organism as first instrumentation, that evolution can and must be. Why? It can be obviously now because consciousness is more free, but must be because you do not have enough time to make a bodily change. If you really want to grow rapidly, you cannot say, all right, we will wait for the bodily changes to keep up. We have to make the bodily change happen, and it must be done if you really want to grow rapidly. But the implication of this is fascinating. It means as you grow in consciousness, there are going to be changes in the body. Your body organization will change to reflect the new powers and new faculties of consciousness. It means even physiologically you should be able to measure certain changes. Now there are interesting studies. People want to see whether there was something special about Einstein's brain that made him intelligent, especially intelligent, or and other things. So they do physiological measures. What is interesting is you do find things like that. But then you do not find that it was a product of heredity. The other brothers in the, or sisters in the family don't have the same thing. And either you can say, well, it was a freak of mutation which made for this unusual capacity, or you have to say it was the consciousness persisting that made this organization change in the brain or other body functions. Even certain gymnasts, in the muscular tissue, there are two kinds of muscles. There are the fast muscles and the slow muscles. The fast muscles can twitch quickly. The slow muscles take longer, but they have greater resilience. They can go on for a longer time. If you're a long distance runner, you need slow muscles. If you're a fast sprinter, you need fast muscles, but you tire out quickly. Now, which of these will it be? Of course, there is a biological basis to it. There will be a shift of heredity. But you could ask what made for that shift of heredity. And eventually you come to the conclusion, if from the beginning you put that intention in training your body, you will actually slant the growth of muscles into more of the fast muscles or more of the slow muscles. And if you have slanted it sufficiently in your body, it will transfer into your progeny. Your children will have that advantage, and so on. So one can say this very interestingly, you can reshape your body's capacities, push them, and with physiological changes, but what you have as physiological imprint can and does pass on to others. So the implication of this is very important. It means right now the body that you have, for whatever benefits or limitations it has, is the product also of the efforts made of your biological ancestors in growth of consciousness. If you belong to a lineage where people have always sought for and worked for a spiritual or a higher development or making the body conscious or dedicating themselves to something worthwhile, even if it is first level, just with the physical growth and capacity, that imprint of that dedicated, concentrated, organized energy is passed on in the heredity and can stamp itself eventually on an entire civilization or culture and give to it a certain direction from the efforts made by the ancestors, but the imprint remains. But in a particular lineage, it can even have very specialized characteristics. And this is fascinating to see. The soul can bring in its own imprint, but it also mixes with things which it has acquired. Between the two, often there could be a contradiction or there could be alignment. And that's why traditionally there is this idea, in India particularly, of offering thanks to your ancestors. But how far does it go back? In the Ayurvedic tradition, they speak of 7 generations. And it goes like this: whatever you do now is imprinted in your biology and will be transmitted 7 generations. Equally, what you've received goes back 7 generations. So you thank them, but also you're conscious of what you do because that also will be transmitted. Sri Aurobindo makes an observation about this. He says, the hereditary transmission is not only in terms of physical material. There is also psychological substance that is transmitted. If you accept that, then it has other implications. It means you can transmit your consciousness growth to others who are not your biological progeny. So we have this very interesting phrasing in Sanskrit, Manasa Putra, literally translated as mental child, mind child. Meaning, somebody can be effectively your progeny in consciousness terms. That is, you transmit the benefit of your consciousness growth into someone without needing a hereditary biological transmission process. And especially if the person has a capacity of receptivity, then you can even transmit psycho-spiritual experiences, capacities, subtleties into a person in this way. So the moment you accept consciousness has a power over body, it's not limited to only your consciousness on your body, it can extend to your consciousness on other bodies also. It's not only what you have inherited from your biological ancestors, but what you have inherited from your spiritual lineage, spiritual home, spiritual guru. And it is not the same thing, you know, everybody says my guru and guru is God. It's not the same thing. What is transmitted can be only what the guru has himself embodied, not experienced in state of consciousness of meditation. Once it is embodied and has acquired a density close to the physical, then it can be transmitted and imprinted into the physical body easily. And so the nature of the sadhana makes a big difference in terms of how much you can transmit. If the sadhana is inherently on the subtler realms and is not fixed in the physical consciousness, there's not much that you can transmit or you cannot transmit easily. Sri Aurobindo and the mother worked to establish everything all the way down to the most physical. And one of the gifts that they have left us is that particular vibration concretized in the physical embodiment of the samadhi, but also in the atmosphere around. And sometimes that is so tangible, you can almost recognize it. I remember visiting somebody's house, and they took us to, it was in a different country, they took us to their meditation room, okay, nice pretty pictures, nice white arrangement, you stepped into it, it had a nice atmosphere, which can happen when people meditate regularly. There was another room in the house which had also a different prayer room, puja room, which had more ritual pujas, that had a very strong power, in fact stronger than the other one, which felt somewhat neglected. But entering this space, immediately I detected a particular vibration and I didn't know how to articulate. Then finally I asked the person, do you have Sri Aurobindo's relics here? And he smiled and nodded, yeah, we're not supposed to tell anybody. So they had, and it was not obvious how they had kept it. It was hidden inside some box. But the vibration was so distinct. And this is when it has been embodied, held in the physical consciousness and is then becoming a point of radiance, physically even. And it has the ability to then imprint into you, almost as if you inherited from your own physical ancestors. I'm maybe dragging this point too much, but it has such practical value that it's worth completing this discussion. A big point is where you identify yourself, with what. If you put too much energy in identifying yourself with your biological ancestry, biological parents, you open to their energy flow. If you put rather all of your identification with your spiritual ancestry and receive the spiritual flow as your primary energy, then you receive much more of this and the biological imprint even becomes fading and can even be removed entirely from your consciousness, leaving only its most material genetic imprints. But energetically, you will not belong anymore to the biological lineage, including all of its negative imprints. It's possible to actually make that shift to a great extent, and it is a point of introspection that we should make what we identify with much more. It was one of the reasons, occult reasons, why when people came to the ashram in the early days, it does not apply now, but when people came to the ashram in the 1930s, they were required to cut off all contact with family completely, not even letters exchanged. If at all you had to have a letter, you had to take mother's permission and so on. And there was a good reason for that. You dedicated yourself entirely to Sri Aurobindo and the mother, opening to them in exclusion to everything else. It allowed for a change which is not possible otherwise. And here we understand the scope of what is possible with this change. So I have digressed, but it is along the same idea that through his consciousness, through its transmutation, and no longer through a new bodily organism as a first instrument, that evolution can and must be effected. And this is possible for us today. This reversal gives to us a great power over our own physical body and its working. I will shortly now explore that. But he says, it's not something new. This was always a truth, that the consciousness had an influence, but it was different earlier. In the inner reality of things, a change of consciousness was always the major fact. The evolution has always had a spiritual significance, and the physical change was only instrumental. Even if you go back to the animal phase and others, it was always first a change of consciousness, and the biological change followed. This was always the case. But this relation was concealed by the first abnormal balance of the two factors, the body of the external inconscience outweighing and obscuring in importance the spiritual element, the conscious being. So in the earlier phase, the balance was abnormal, and it concealed the inner consciousness, and its influence was also concealed. Now the implication of this is also quite extraordinary. It means even in an animal body, this thing is happening. And this process can be assisted. And this is why Mother observes many dogs and other individualized beings, when they come in contact with human beings, it helps their mental evolution. And if the dog is sufficiently conscious, you will even find them watching you intently, as if their mind is reaching out, or they are connecting to your mind and absorbing some substance of your mind. And such a transmission does take place. Not only that, something more also happens. In a few animals, and this is possible with dogs and cats particularly, the psychic center within can also be sufficiently conscious that it will relate to a human being in whom the psychic center is sufficiently awakened, and it will seek nourishment from that. And the human being, equally in giving affection, can assist, if they are centered in the psychic, can assist the emergence and organization of personality around the psychic in the animal. Generally, when this happens, or it happens automatically in nature, that an animal has a strongly individualized psychic being, then we speak of that animal as a king soul of the species. So there was one such in the ashram where Medhananda had brought a monkey, and when it came to the mother, it became extremely docile and was behaving in a very conscious, as if a human form. And mother recognized and said that this is a king monkey. And when in the cage it was given another monkey to mate, it refused. It simply went and caressed the monkey, which was afraid, and then set it aside and kept its royalty. And in its behavior, there is a very interesting incident narrated. There was a traditional swami from traditional Hindu lineage wearing ochre robes, who went with his retinue to see the monkey. And as soon as it entered, the monkey looked at him, recognized something, went up to him and made gestures and sounds as if it was conversing. And that Swami nodded and smiled, and the monkey nodded and smiled. It was literally as if they were having a conversation. But it was so mature, so individualized, so human. But these things actually happen. They are possible, and there can be a human influence in assisting this. But what's the problem there? The balance of the inner and outer. The shell of the outer is too obscuring, and so you do not see that it was the inner which was influencing the outer. The inconscience outweighing and obscuring. But once the balance has been righted, it is no longer the change of body that must precede the change of consciousness. The consciousness itself, by its mutation, will necessitate and operate whatever mutation is needed for the body. Now, this is an extraordinary statement, because he's using the word mutation. It's not just change. So it's one thing that your consciousness changes your muscles to make them stronger, to make them more elastic by doing regular exercise. Okay, your biology changes. But that's only change. He's speaking of something more profound. The mutation itself. The consciousness itself, by its mutation, will necessitate and operate whatever mutation is needed for the body. And body change is not required before change of consciousness. And we are at that stage. Again, to different degrees, and particularly different degrees in different parts of our body. Now, for example, in your hand, you are much more conscious. And so a skill developed, an intention put, work done on the hand consciousness will yield much more rapidly than, say, the feet, which are much less conscious, much more unconscious. Or abdominal regions, which are generally unconscious for most people, except those who have worked on the body in some way. If you can work on all the parts of your body thoroughly, to make all these parts as conscious as possible, then literally from your mind awareness, you can feel the whole body, hold it in the grip of your mind, and shape it like that, in a grip. Or at the very least, do that inner part of the body. Take your hand and hold your awareness, grip the hand with your mind's awareness, and infuse an intention for it to become warmer, for it to become more supple, whatever. You will feel the change happening rapidly, certain changes. Mutational changes, of course, taking a little longer. You can increase the number of nerve connections and thereby increase the sensitivity of the fingers or fingertips. And this is well within our capacity as we are today, even at a late age. But if you can grip the whole body, you can even change the shape of the body. And Sri Aurobindo records this action which he did on his own body. And there is documentation even to support that. If you see the photographs of his body before he entered jail, or at the time when he entered jail, and then subsequently, even the facial form has changed, even the body shape has changed. And he records in his diary notes how the waist became narrower. The bone structure itself changed. But the bone structure change took several years to finally settle, because obviously it's as if the consciousness is putting a shift, and now the cells, as they are replaced, they take on the new form. But the replacement of process of the cells takes at most 7 years, particularly for the bones. For the skin cells, it can be a few days. For the tissue under, it can be a few weeks or months, depending on where and how deep, and so on. Your blood cells, again a question of a few days, I believe 20 to 40 days, depending on which cells in the bloodstream. But the moment you start putting a will, and if you hold a sustained will, all of these things begin to change. And the potential for how far you can change is quite extraordinary. So, the consciousness itself, by its mutation, you mutate your consciousness, will necessitate and operate whatever mutation is needed for the body. It will make it necessary and do whatever is needed. You don't have to be looking inside the cellular working. The intention made or your consciousness shifted, the internal workings, it will adjust in the way it needs. And this includes also possibilities of your brain, by the way. Growth of your nervous system, because these are the most conscious parts, the most subtle, responsive to the mind. Mother's observation in the 50s was, when you read Sri Aurobindo, new nerve cells grow in your brain. And that at that time people said, oh, it's not possible. At that time they taught you that the brain stops growing new cells. Today the evidence is actually proving what mother spoke of at that point, which was contrary to science then. But this can be so extraordinary that a person actually develops within a few years a level of intelligence they have never demonstrated in all of their life up to adulthood. And it does not matter what age it is. It has to be noted that the human mind has already shown a capacity to aid nature in the evolution of new types of plant and animal. It has created new forms of its environment, developed by knowledge and discipline, considerable changes in its own mentality. It is not an impossibility that man should aid nature consciously also in his own spiritual and physical evolution and transformation. The urge to it is already there and partly effective, though still incompletely understood and accepted by the surface mentality. Now, this is another extraordinary statement. We are going through a series of extraordinary statements because you have to see the implications of this. So the position he has taken is that the mind is already able to help nature in evolution of new types of plants and animals. We do this at first through crossbreeding, now through genetic intervention, and the latest is by a particular genetic technique called CRISPR, by which literally you drink a liquid which has the CRISPR cells. It gets into your body, and wherever the liquid spreads, it starts engaging with the genetic structure, removing, cutting out elements or inserting new elements. And as a result, certain inherited diseases can be edited out from your genes. And the method for it is either injecting in blood or drinking, depending on how you're going to deliver, whichever is the most effective way of delivery. Now think about the implications. If the structure which you're putting in is sufficiently small, it can even seep in through the skin, through the pores of the skin. So imagine you apply some ointment or you inject a liquid into the blood, and as this spreads, it starts making genetic mutations. This is the technology currently available. The implications are staggering. You can remove inherited diseases. You can insert new traits. And we're doing this already with plants and animals, at least in the laboratory. It's extremely dangerous in terms of potential for misuse, but extremely powerful for potential for good use also. The problem is we don't always know the side effects of whatever interventions we make. Our knowledge is still weak. But potentially, since we are able to help nature in making changes to plants and animals, why can't we do it to ourselves? But when it comes to ourselves, he suggests both spiritual and physical evolution. And this has, again, very interesting idea, suggestions. Physical evolution we can understand, yes, we will make a genetic intervention, or at least through diet and other means, amplify, modify the body's capacities. You notice the body has certain built-in clocks. At a certain age, certain things kick in. At a certain age, the aging process begins, and so on. What if you could interfere with the clocks themselves? What if you could even reverse some of the aging processes? And these have been demonstrated in rats in the laboratories. Why not with human beings? And the technology already exists, but it is kept held back for whatever interests. Yes. Now, but that is one side. But this other suggestion is the change spiritually. In your spiritual evolution and transformation, what is possible? Now, this takes two forms. First form is recognizing that in our brain there are structures which correspond to mind and mental functions. And if those structures have more neuronal cells, then those functions of the mind, of course, are more free. Or if you train those functions of the mind, then those cells in the brain have more neuronal connections or cells. Is there something similar connected with the spiritual? Now, one of the interesting things we do notice is corresponding to what is called the third eye in the subtle body, center of will and vision, there is in the physical body the pineal gland. Corresponding to the sense of the center of our identity, there is in the brain the center which is the pituitary gland. Literally, physically also taking the location of the center. If you look at the structures of these two glands, they have extraordinary suggestions. The pineal gland, third eye, is actually photosensitive. It responds to light. Although it's buried inside the brain, behind your forehead, it's responsive to light. Now you'd wonder, when does light actually enter your brain? And it does, a little bit does penetrate the skull. If you look through your hands, you can often make out at least through thin tissue, light does go in, and it's extremely sensitive. But it is responsive also to light which comes on the forehead, interestingly. And it controls the sleep cycle, it controls melatonin and serotonin, which control your body's regeneration. So if you can somehow work through it, the melatonin and serotonin cycles, you can actually trigger the cells of your body to be asked to become more fresh, more youthful, less aged. And it's controlled from there, the center of will and vision, interestingly. But if this gland is more active, would it correspond to a stronger will and a power of vision, or at least subtle sight? And there is evidence to show that it does. So if that gland is clear and functional, one is naturally more easily perceptive of things in the subtle domain. Or if you work in consciousness terms to develop that subtler awareness, this gland begins to activate and becomes more functional, and so on. Now the suggestion is, there can be a physiological reflection of your change of consciousness. But if for some reason you take in food which dulls the physiological working, on the one side your consciousness is growing, on the other side the food will act like a weight, dulling the part which would allow you to express that consciousness. And again, there is interesting studies. There are studies which show that the pituitary gland actually becomes more and more calcified by certain substances in your food, water, or bloodstream. And one of those substances, unfortunately, is being dumped into the water in certain countries. In the United States of America, they are dumping in the drinking water fluoride. And there's no good reason for doing it. The reason given to you is that it is good for your teeth. Well, if it's good for your teeth, apply it with a toothbrush. You don't have to drink it and put it in your bloodstream for your teeth. In fact, studies show that fluoride is a poison. It used to be used for killing insects in buildings. But in very mild doses, it makes you extremely suggestible and complacent and obedient. So a tiny dose of it in drinking water makes the whole population obedient and suggestible. You can tell them anything, they'll believe you, they will accept, and they'll obey without rebelling. And so perhaps there is an ulterior motive. But the effect of that in the water over a few years is to calcify, harden the pineal gland and the pituitary functions. And effectively, it would have the result of dulling some of your higher perception of consciousness. So I'm looking at the physiological connection with the spiritual consciousness change. You can still, by conscious effort, open to higher, and there'll be a pushback of consciousness on the biology and other benefits. But if the biology is not supportive, there'll be a heaviness that you will feel in the ascent or in the awakening. If the biology is clear and fresh and pure and responsive, you will not have as much resistance. And we see this immediately when we begin to detoxify our body by curing it of dulling, heavy foods. Your mind becomes clear, bright, fresh. You start eating the dulling and junk foods, again your mind becomes dull after a while. So if it can do that to the mind and the higher faculties of mind, well, it will influence also the higher spiritual axis, let's say. So we can intervene even biologically in other ways. So one of the methods used is to stimulate parts of the brain, and immediately it has the effect of as if expanding the consciousness. So they called it the God helmet. You put on the helmet, it triggers certain centers which gives you an altered state of consciousness, but it doesn't last. The benefit of that is lasting at best about an hour, and then it fades out. Also, you've stimulated the nerves. When the nerves are stimulated, they need to go back to sleep to rest. And so it's as if having had a high, it's followed by a low. So you have a high of 1 hour followed by a low, and over time the nerves become insensitive to the stimulation. So over time you cease to have the ability to have the high, but you tend to have longer lows. So like drugs, in time you lose the benefit of access. On the contrary, if the same person is given certain meditation practices for 15 minutes a day, but sustained every day, you find exactly the same benefit, not lasting 1 hour, lasting through the day with none of the negative results. Now this is pure research done on double blind tests and so on, clinical research, which shows that actually your brain functions are operating at the age of 50, of a biological 50-year-old, your brain functions operate like a 25-year-old just by meditation practices, 15 minutes every day, but sustained. And no 1 hour boost, you have a sustained boost. But again, there are very interesting suggestions, implications of how technology could be used to assist in some way. But finally, it will be change of consciousness. And consciousness changing will assist biology, or change biology, even mutate the biology. So here is an alignment of nature's working in us and our conscious working, and the aspect of knowledge and technology by which we can greatly speed up certain things. But there will be a condition. So here's Sri Aurobindo points out how we have developed by knowledge and discipline considerable changes in its own mentality. Now that we know how the mind works, we know how the brain learns, we can actually follow certain processes in our self-training by which we can learn better, absorb better, and retain better, or develop the powers of the mind more rapidly, and so on. And one could look at many of these learning techniques which are based on a deeper insight. But now take this to culmination. What if your deeper insight could go all the way to a deepest insight which gives you a means even more powerful? And this is what he points to. The urge to it is already there and partly effective, though still incompletely understood and accepted by the surface mentality. But one day, it may understand, your surface mentality may understand, go deeper within itself and discover the means, the secret energy, the intended operation of the consciousness force within, which is the hidden reality of what we call nature. So if you see, this is your nature you're shaping with your consciousness. If you go deep enough into what you call your nature, you will discover there the consciousness force which is secret behind, and it will reveal the secret energy and secret means by which it can enormously speed up and make effective this change. The result would be, even without a physiological support, the consciousness and especially the inner power pushing forward would make for such rapid changes that you would have had the benefit of a physical, biological mutation even, but without needing too much physiological change. Part of the consciousness liberated. And so this is where we will end the paragraph. And the suggestion is very important. There will be new tools, there will be new methods which will come our way, new learning techniques even, by which we will be able to greatly accelerate our self-development of mental capacities and even spiritual. There are means already available by which one can learn new languages using subliminal learning methods, where you can master a new language, they say, in 20 days. not everybody is automatically responsive to it, but the idea is you go within into your subliminal states, like a semi-hypnotic or a meditative state, and there you open and receive the imprint of the language. And the result is it is deeply held and spontaneously expressed. So techniques like that are being experimented with, but without a real understanding of what's happening behind. But the most powerful such method will be the direct access to the energy, which right now is working indirectly through nature. It will work directly in us. All these are conclusions that can be arrived at even from the observation of the outward phenomena of nature's progression. But having said this, we are only seeing the outside. What about the inner? And this is what he will take up in the next paragraph. The invisible factor, the rebirth and progress of the soul by ascent from grade to grade. What about that? So this we will study on Sunday after next. And next Sunday, since I will be out of station, for those who are interested, we will play a video of some other themes which may be of interest to keep the mood of the study. But we will continue this passage on the 19th of May. We can pause on this and meditate for a while.